Rangers,
Rangers,
all the way,
all the way.
Here we go,
here we go,
here we go.
Hey there, here we are again, three of us, actually four of us, because we're going to include David on this one. And this is going to be just a shit chat conversation. We might say something that you might remember of an incident that happened in your time in the service. I was just telling the guys earlier, when I went to airborne school, it was pretty rough. But then I couldn't quit. And the reason I couldn't quit, because my dad was the post sergeant major. And that's just one, you know, and I'll tell you a quick story since we all chit-chatting right now. When I got to Fort Benning from Fort Chaffee, Arkansas, they took us right to the airborne barracks. Well, there was an E-6 in charge, and he was just the baddest thing in the world. You know, he just, you know, bringing the max on all of us. Well, he had no idea my dad was Sergeant Major Post. Well, anyway, so my dad drives up to the barracks, and then he walks inside the barracks. And the E-6, yes, how you make it? What can I do for you? What can I do? You know? And I got treated a little bit different, you know, but I knew why. But the best story I had, I thought, on Sundays, we would go to church either to Lourdes or on Post. And then we would go to the NCO club, okay? And then some of my dad's subordinates, they came by, Sergeant Major, how you doing? Just fine. And I said, Sergeant Major, permission to speak to your son. Well, sure, go ahead. He said, son, you're mine tomorrow. Tomorrow I'm going to be your mom, your dad. And my dear mom, she just didn't understand that. What is he talking about? He's going to be his mom, his dad, you know. But, you know, we all had our great times in the service. And can you remember any specific time that picked that in your mind?
Oh, yeah. I got too many of those to think about, really. I was 13 in the lottery, and I got my draft notice, but I was doing my student teaching at Eddie Junior High, and I decided I was going to join the Navy because I didn't, like a naive idiot, didn't think they were too involved in Vietnam because you didn't see much of that on TV. I love the water. I had a lifeguarder for, well, I don't know, six summers, I think, but I had worked my way up to aquatic instructor, which is as high as you can go in the life-saving field. And I was scuba certified at 16, so I said, well, I'd join the Navy, you know. But here again, I didn't want to go to Vietnam. So I joined the Navy, go to boot camp. And to me,
funniest thing!
That was a walk in the park. Well, I volunteered for BUDS and got accepted, passed everything. And
so what is BUDS?
Basic Unordered Demolition Seal. And we had a class.
Excuse me, basic what?
Unordered Demolition Seal.
Oh.
And we started with a class of 52, and 12 of us finished. I went from the West Coast, San Diego, to the East Coast to pick up interior, Saratoga. She was being deployed to the Gulf of Tonkin. And so I reported on board her. And we crossed the equator. And I had been put in indoctrination division, I division. And that's where the mess cooks go. And ship's command master chief had some paperwork with my name on it, and they were trying to, you know, get the special ops guys together so we could deploy separately. And he found me down at the butcher shop on board the Saratoga cutting meat. And of course, when he walks in, everything stopped, you know, and the petty officer in charge, you know, what can I do for you, master chief? And he said, so you got a kid named Hartman down here? Yeah. Aye, sir, we do. And of course, any chief of any caliber, you say sir to him, he's going to light you up. And it's exactly what happened. He said, I work for a damn living. Don't call me sir. So he said, he pointed him out to me, and the command master chief said, come go with me, son. Leave your apron. I'm in kitchen white, sort of speaking. I had a white apron with blood all over it. So I just take it off and I handed it to this first class petty officer, and I said, sucks being you, done. I walked right the passageway with this command master chief, and he says, go to your division and get cleaned up. Put your own your dungarees and whatnot. Meet me up in the chaplain's office. Well, at that point, I thought I had, you know, something happening at home. And so I meet up there and hear some of these other special ops guys, and this lieutenant walks in and he's wearing a trident, and I didn't know him. He was several classes ahead of me. And he said, all right, fellas, this is, we're going to be jumping off this ship here before too long. And here again, you know, I haven't quite grasped all of the Navy nuances. I'd say, well, wait a minute, I didn't come here to jump on no aircraft here.
Funny thing.
Yeah, the first time I heard the word COD, you know, which is the plane that they, you know, bring mail in, some supplies.
Our people.
And that's what they did. They flew us off there and flew us in the Philippines, which the Saratoga was headed to. But they wanted us to get there a little quicker. So I went over there and I picked up the USS Welch Patrol Gunboat 93. She was heavy seas worthy, and from there I went into Vietnam, picked up my orders to go to the USS Harnett County, which is a mothership where all the patrol boats marry up to, so to speak. And then I spent the next three tours running up and down the Mekong and the Bay-Sock River.
Really? Wow.
You know, it's amazing.
As a cook.
So let me ask you this about your Navy SEAL training. How long of a school is that?
Well, when I went through it, it was 24 weeks.
Is that what you guys, I mean, they got you running up and down the beaches and then exercising with logs and doing sit-ups and all that?
Old Faithful.
Is that right?
Yeah, you got to carry Old Faithful.
Oh, okay. So you was like a SEAL. Was that a SEAL training, what you had?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. All right. Well, you know.
Rangers are just SEAL wannabes. You know that, don't you?
Rangers are what?
SEAL wannabes.
Oh, is that right?
I've been waiting a long time to tell him.
You know,
you got a space raider in that sign over there.
Yeah. you know, it's amazing to listen to other people training, because I'm, you know, I was just Army, you know, and I hear this other lingo going on, and
we have is our own language.
It's just,
our own language.
Just like I heard in the Navy, I heard, but that guy's a captain. I thought, golly, he's been in the service. Oh, he's a captain. He must have messed up somewhere along the line.
And I tell you what, I don't know Lenny, and didn't know him until two luncheons ago, and he sought me out and come up and introduced himself, said, I understand you're a Navy, and we just kind of hit it off right there. But you'd be surprised at the captains that I say milk that from the standpoint of letting you think that they're stupid if you only made 03, you know, which is an Army equivalent to lieutenant. But when they say captain, very few people think about being in the Navy and being an 06. That's a colonel in your branch.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they wear that big eagle. So, you know.
Big difference.
A lot of difference.
Well, the joy is having people like you around, you know. It's like my wife, she was questioning me, and I said, you know, I never had to give an order. I never had to give an order when I was in command. And she'd say, what do you mean you never had to get an order? I said, I just walk around and talk to the guys and say, you know, Chief, what about this or what about that? Next thing you know, it was done. I mean, they just took care of it.
When I was a first class petty officer,
amazing.
An E6, I had a lieutenant commander come on board, and of course, where I was, you know, the patrol boats were in squadrons, and so he was a squad leader, responsible for X number of patrol boats, like Lenny was, you know, squadron commander for VA, whatever it was, X number of aircraft or personnel. And he'd been there about 6 weeks, and he called me in for an evaluation at that time. And he said, I don't know how in the living hell you get so much done as an E6. Because we didn't have a chief on board. And he says, I just don't understand it. I said, well, I treat them like I want to be treated.
That's right.
I said, I don't have to give orders. And I never gave an order as an E6. And very few as a chief. Because once you get the rank, and if you got what it takes to get there and the personality that you have to display, because when I made chief, I had a whole lot of friends that wanted to still call me by my first name. That gets nixed immediately. You know, you can't do that, not in the Navy. And so, you're going to be the one that they go to. The mantra in the Navy is go ask the chief, right?
That's right.
You know, Lenny, I was going to mention something while we were talking, and I know whenever before we went to Iran, we used to go to camp, God bless it, in California, camp for desert training. Well, the time that we went to desert training, the Air Force was involved. And boy, and I watched it from a distance, you know, boy, they're coming down and go back up, you know. So just so happened, one was coming behind us. And this guy, you better duck. I thought I was being fired with the dirt and all that. I had no idea there was that much fire coming out of those engines that he stirred up all the dirt. I mean, I was being bombarded with dirt. And it don't take but one time to learn. You know, you see him coming, you better duck what you said. I thought it looked nice, just like in the movies, boy, to come down at the distance, but when they come behind you, oh boy, you know. And it's funny, you think those planes are not that big? Pretty good sized planes, yeah. Pretty good sized plane. David, can you remember anything that happened on your time?
Well, like them, so many different things happened. It's hard to distinguish one particular incident.
Absolutely, David.
I know.
We'll see.
Especially if you're not thinking ahead, pre-thinking ahead of it ahead of time. But the main thing I can think is the camaraderie that you have with all the guys that you serve with, and women too. I mean, you had women that you served with. That's something new now in the military, to go out before bidding and see infantry women. Now, that's just different to me because in my time in the service, it was all male role.
I'll give you something here to laugh about. There was two females that were chiefs before me. And, back then, in days of old, when men were bold, in the Navy, unlike all the other branches, chiefs were initiated. You were tested, selected, initiated. And
I enjoyed my chief initiation.
So, did you have drug procurement?
No, but I got to go to several chief initiations.
Well, bless your heart. You're lucky.
Very blessed.
But I had two women, and they were good chiefs. They're still good friends of mine today. But you were given a costume that you had to wear the night of initiation. And mine required me to wear a jock strap. And I had to put two raw eggs in the jock strap. And
not break them.
Yeah.
Well, he could break them. Somebody
I could break them, but my favorite chief walked up to me one day and she said, "Hartman, for 2 years I wanted to bust your balls." And she reached down and grabbed both those eggs and crushes them. You might want to edit that part.
But I can bleep it out.
But that right there was a life changing moment in sure. My career as a chief.
In the airborne, after you go through airborne school and you get assigned to Fort Campbell, you're getting ready to make your sixth jump. We call those cherry jumpers. Well, before the jump. And this happened in my company. I've seen the guys. We had, there was three floors, but you know, on the second story, they had a ledge. We do PLFs from the second ledge for the new guys. Position landing fall, you know? And it's funny, they get over there, it's a son, unless you do a PLF right here, you're out, you know? I don't know, they never got me on that, but I've seen that happen, you know? You stand in front of a ledge. You practice your PLFs at around 6 foot high. You're looking about 10, 12 foot high. That's a long ways. But then once you break your cherry, once you make that six jump, then you know, bingo.
You talking about things that come back to memory when I was at boot camp in Orlando, which was like a college campus back then. We had the fourth week's swim week, and you do all kinds of different things, and you always have to look out for your buddy. And having been a lifeguard, it was kind of a natural thing for me. But the last day, the instructors were getting ready to dismiss everybody, and the first class petty officer, he got a clipboard and he called six names out. He says, "Idiot, stay here, and the rest of you go to the showers." I'm like, "Well, who are you calling an idiot?" You know, I assume he was there just, you know, I didn't know if he was lifeguard qualified or that was just part of his duty assignment for the week or something. Anyway, he says, sits us on a bleacher, and directly one of these big old burly guys comes off the dive board and just face plants on a belly buster from the high dive. Well, we didn't know why he had us there, but momentarily he called a guy by name and says, "You got an active drowning victim here, go get him." Well, this kid makes a perfect lifeguard entry, swims up, does his lifeguard dive, turns the guy around, crawls up his chest, goes into a cross chest carrier, brings him over the side, gets him out of the water. Very
wow.
Good.
Wow.
Well, I was impressed. I mean, that's just textbook the way he did it. So the next guy, instructor, goes off the dive board. He comes up and he's passively drowning. So you have two different techniques. So he does this five times. I'm the last one. Now, I already have my aquatic instructor, and I think that's why he saved me for the end. Well, he just didn't know how far ahead of him I was. So my guy goes off the dive board and does a half gainer, and he booms, Billy's out.
Oh,
so wow. he's kind of half alive and half dead. He said, go get him. So I walk down the end of the dive board on the wall, and I take a shepherd's crook off, and I walk over, and I hook him, and I bring him aside, sit, hook down, cross wrist him, bob him up, down, set him up, pull him out, set him up for CPR, and he says, how would you like to go lifeguard at the Petty Officers Club? I spent my last 6 weeks in boot camp in Orlando Petty Officers Club lifeguard.
You know, when I was in high school, on post at Bryant Wells Fieldhouse, y'all remember
yeah.
that?
Oh, yeah.
That's where I learned how to swim. And then I got pretty good with the jumping off the low dive. And I could swim the underwater all the way from one end to the other. I got real good. Then I got a job at the Officers Club,
right.
Lifeguard.
That was the second one I had, was that there?
Yeah. And it was interesting, you know. It was just that was I liked that job, but then I'll tell you another story that happened to me. See, I played football for Fort Benning while I was a senior in high school until August. They started practicing June, 1st of June, games in July, practice, you know, and then their regular season. Well, we had a guy named Sergeant Malik. He was the equipment manager for Fort Benning. His son went to Baker. And Sergeant Malik, we were at Bryant Wells Fieldhouse, and he said, Ish, come on with me. I'm gonna show you a game that's gonna make you a good football player, a better football player. I'm listening. Yeah, I was pretty good size. I was 6'1", weighed 235, 32-inch waistline, you know, and I used to work out all the time. So it was handball, playing handball.
Oh, yeah.
And I got real good with it. So then Fort Benning's gonna start practicing. I'm laughing already at it. Anyway, so I said, do you care if I practice? No, I'll talk to the coach. The coach, I forgot his name, but I can see his face right now. Real friendly guy. You know, I mean, he was a smaller guy, about your height, really. And he had baseball pants, you know, baseball pants. Well, you know, I was the big dog in school, but I got them guy. I wasn't the big dog with all those guys. So the coach, we practiced at the end of practice, got us everybody in. He's a guy, we got a new player, we got a new player with us. He goes to high school, and I cannot pronounce his name. So we're gonna call him High School Harry. So I was High School Harry to those guys. Now, here it is, 1963. Fort Benning goes to Fort Campbell. We're playing Fort Campbell. And I didn't want to play in that game because those are my friends over there. So what happens, you know, we're warming up, and my coach and the coach before me, they're at the 50-yard line. Of all the sudden, I hear his voice, Harry, come here. And I knew whose voice that was. That's the other coach. I just walked over there, and my coach later on said, I didn't know that was his first name. And he goes, nah, hell, we just can't pronounce his name, so we call him High School Harry. You know? So I remember the coach telling me, he said, Harry, if you don't play against us, like you when you're playing for us against the other people, those 50 guys, they're going to whip your butt. And I looked at all those guys, and they all raised their thumbs up. You know, that was a big emotional moment for me. But you know, it was a great story. And then that was the day they shot Kennedy. And then some of those guys were snipers. And I see we went to this service clubs in Fort Campbell, watching it on TV like everybody else. And the guys over there, the snipers, Oswald did not kill Kennedy, not with that weapon. And you know, they're right. You know, they still don't want to tell the truth. And I'm like everybody, I don't want to get into politics right now. Anyway.
I agree.
Well, what do you think, David? Long enough? Okay. Folks, I hope you enjoyed it. I hope we reminded you of something, you know, funny. If you're watching and you're a veteran, why don't you join us? You know, I'll put a notice out. I'll get in touch with Kathy Bowden, and she'll notify me that you're a veteran, you like to be interviewed. We had two more other guys coming. One of them, his wife is not doing well. And David, my mind just went blank. Your teacher, Jim
Hayes.
Jim Hayes, class of 1962. I learned about the Navy from him. Well, I'll tell you what, I didn't know that you're in Cuba. Christ, they were all outside Cuba, ready to go in, you know. It was really interesting. And I did not know that the 82nd Airborne was down there too until I moved here.
Well, now Putin's put nuclear weapons in Cuba again.
Yep, that's right. I just don't like the situation we're in, you know.
I agree.
You know, I tell people, if a dumb old boy from Becker High School can figure out what's going on or what could happen, we're in trouble.
We're in a world of...
Yeah.
But one of the biggest problems is we know for a fact that when they took that paddle away from the teachers and the parents, that's when you started having problems. Because you don't have no discipline anymore, no respect. That's gone now.
And you know, one thing I have to say, Becker and all the other schools, a lot of your male teachers, they were veterans.
Oh, sure.
You know, they were bad. They were interested in us.
Mr. Hayes was a vet. He was my teacher, and he paddled me before. I never said it to him. Well, I wasn't going to give him the satisfaction, but he paddled me before.
Well, I'm going to tell you it just floored me. My wife and I got married, but I haven't moved back here yet. And I was in for the weekend, and my wife and I went to Walmart, and we heard this voice. I said, I know who that is. That's Mr. Boyles. And that was him and his wife. So I said, hey, Mr. Boyles, how you doing? Fine-ish, you know. He was in our wedding. Mr. Boyles at our wedding told my wife, typical Mr. Boyles, Sandy, if he gets off hand, let me know. I'll straighten him up, you know. So anyway, so I walked to him. I said, he said, well, Ish, how often do you come to Columbus? Well, normally about every three or four weeks, but I'm going to come back in 2 weeks because I'm pinning the airborne wings on my neighbor. Oh, I know all about that. You know about what? Airborne. I said, explain that. I was airborne too. You were airborne, Mr. Boy, and you knew that was going to be a blood brother, and you whipped me like you did. and his story is fantastic. When he went to airborne school, first of all, his name was Oscar P. Boyles, right? Does anybody know what the P stands for?
Well, it wasn't Philip. It was a strange name.
I'm not going to say it because I heard the story before.
Yeah.
Something you wouldn't have.
You would have never guessed it in a million years. His middle name was Prentice.
Prentice. I said Princess, but.
Yeah, Prentice. And he was known not as Oscar, as Prentice.
Oh,
as Prentice,
really?
Yeah. And they could have wrote a book about him. He was a special person. You know, one thing, I tell you what, my dad and all the other parents, they won't worry about us because Mr. Ball would take care of them.
My mom and him were first name basis in 1966. Myself as a sophomore and two seniors decided we're going to wear plaid pants to school.
Gonna wear what?
Plaid pants when they came out.
Plaid trousers.
With a nice collared sports shirt that went with it, but just plaid pants. Well, it wasn't a dress code approved, and so we got turned in, and we all had to go see Oscar P. And we're like, okay, what if, you know, we're not wearing inappropriate clothes. We are dressed nice and neat. I had Palomino loafers and a Palomino belt on and, you know, plaid pants and a solid color shirt. We thought we looked cool. Well, it was just a rebellion type move, you know. But anyway, we're in his office and he comes in and said, boys, I hate to tell you this, but those pants y'all are wearing aren't approved. And we're like, by who? He said, the dress code. Well, where's the dress code written? Of course, you know. You just didn't want to. That was not the right thing to do, and I knew it. But I had two seniors there, and I was just building. I was just making sure I was running with a pack, you know. But the more they talked, you know, the deeper it got. So finally, he said, "Look," he said, "I'm going to settle this right now." He said, "I'm going to give you all three licks," and I said, "Really?" He said, "Yeah." Well, I'm going to give you two licks, and Lance, I'm going to just call your mom. And I said, wait a minute. I said, I was in trouble with these two. I'm going to stand for them. You can give me my licks. Okay. So he busted my butt. three times.
And then called
him. And then he turned around and called my mom.
I knew that was coming.
A good story about that, Mr. Ball, he used to get in trouble often. Mr. Blueharty, that was his principal's name. He got caught doing something, and he had to go see Mr. Blueharty. He said, "Well, Prentice, I'm gonna give you some licks, or else you can have your dad give you some licks." And Mr. Ball said, "Mr. Blueharty, you give me the licks. If my dad gives me, he'll kill me." You know, it's Well, guys, thank you for a good chit-chat section. And if you folks, anyone of you guys, want to join us, come on, join us. You know, we always find something to talk about. All you got to do is just mention something. So I hope if you're interested, call Kathy Bowden on the website and let her know that you let me know. Okay? We'll see y'all later, and guys, thank you a lot.
Appreciate it.
Thank you,
Captain.
Sure.
Enjoyed
thank
it.
Thank you,
Colonel. All right.
Thank you.